So, schools, a thing of the past, is it? Naya, if you think I came 1,000 miles to tell you that schools are a thing of the past, no, that's not the reason I'm here. The reason I'm here is because I want to network with you. I want to find people who share the same dream that I have for my country and for the world. And you have a dream for Africa, and I want to join that dream for Africa. This is the main reason I'm here. Having said that, I don't mean that schools are not a thing of the past. Indeed, they are, but maybe not as we know them today. So schools, as we know them today, I believe they are a thing of the past. And what is the proof? 200 years ago, there were no schools. Schools is a construction of the modern world. Go back and read a little bit about schools. They have been invented in order to take kids away from their mothers and let mothers go to job. What is going to change is these four words. I say in the near future. In some countries it's already changing, in some other countries it's a little later. But what I want you to keep as my main message today, even if you keep only one message, is this: that the what, the how, the when, and the why we learn are going to fundamentally change. The what is going to change because there is an explosion of knowledge. We have to choose. We cannot eat all the marmalades. We have to choose. The how, that's why we are here. We are talking about e-learning, mobile learning, new ways of learning. It's changing the way we learn. The when, we used to think wrongly that we learn in schools. Now, I'm telling you, that's wrong. Most of the things we know, we didn't learn them in school. People give too much credit to the school. The reason we learn all the time is because we have mobile learning since we were created. We carry the learning machine in the skull wherever we go. And we learn from day zero. Now the why is what I love the most. We have to stop learning because we need to get a job. We have to go beyond that. We want to learn because we want to develop as human beings. Of course we need to learn to get a job, but that shouldn't be the only reason. We want a community, a society where people learn for pleasure, learn for development, learn for becoming philosophers, becoming more humans. I can leave this slide for a minute if you want to read all the messages, because every time I go to the European Commission, I go around once a month for various projects, in one of their main conference areas, they have these signs. And I photograph them and I put them here for you. Now, for me, they mean a lot. Because we keep thinking that the future is something that is going to come. It's something that we have to anticipate, to predict, to prepare for. It's all wrong. The future is something we can create. It's not something that just comes. And this is where we are wrong. There is a whole unit in the European Commission called Digital Task Force. It has one project called Futurium. If you haven't visited it, please visit it, become members, and share your ideas. It's about shaping the future. Because what we do today will define what will happen tomorrow. There are many possible futures. So it's up to us to choose what we want and make it happen. And you are in a good position here in Africa. Don't think that you are disadvantaged because you are behind technologically or economically. You might be advantaged because you have not been corrupted with the previous technology and previous thinking. So you can move fresh and design your own future. Now, just to introduce also a little bit about myself, We have this small university. It has only 20 PhD students, and all of them have the same subject, designing the future. So if anybody has any ideas or would like to know more about it, please talk to me anytime during the days I am here. Like I said, I'm here to network, and anything you hear in my talk that you would like to have or use, send me an email if you don't catch me here. Now, I want to tell you something about this Core Foresight workshop, it's called. It's about Europe 2050. Once a month, we have meetings with different key stakeholders from all over the world, and there are many themes, but guess what? Education is, of course, one of the hottest. It's continuously been chosen as one of the top five. So e-learning is one of the top five priorities also in the European Commission, and you are standing in the middle of it. And you are well positioned. Now, I want to share with you some thoughts here. All the walls are breaking down, and I'm going to explain that a bit more. Classroom walls, the computer has broken classroom walls because students now have access to the outside world through their computer. The school perimeter is breaking down because there are a lot of ideas coming from outside. The geographic walls are breaking down because we can have information from other countries. If you have good infrastructure, you can also use video conferencing and connect with classrooms around the world. Subject domain walls are changing. We used to have mathematics, chemistry, physics, biology. Now, believe me, that's all history. We don't need this classification of subjects anymore because we cannot teach everything. We need to be teaching math while at the same time teaching computers and at the same time making our kids responsible for the environment. How do we combine this? That's the challenge. Now, I prepared some images to help you visualize how the school system is changing. This is how we grew up in the 20th century. We speak about the 20th century as if it was millenniums ago. Now, yeah, I'll tell you something. I don't know if you feel like me, but we are the luckiest people who have ever lived on this planet. A few hundred years before us, there were wars, people were poor, they knew very little things about how the world works. And here we are, we live longer, we live healthier, we live in peace. There are not so many wars as they were a couple of hundred years ago. And in front of us, there are not so promising days coming if we don't take care of it. Now, this is how we grew up. Our generation, and maybe some kids still here in Africa might be growing up this way. There is a classroom that is homogeneous. All kids are from the same country. There is a teacher who is in the middle of it. That's why I made him red. And there is some bookshelves where they can get information. But now the kids grow in a different world. The wall is broken. They might have a computer in the classroom. So the teacher is not the person who knows everything. He's not in the middle anymore. And teachers have to know that. They cannot play the game as if they have to know everything, as if they have to have all the attention. The attention, their role is changing. Their role is now the role of a facilitator, of a mentor, of a supporter, of a coach. Now, most people talk about this model now, but I think we are moving beyond that model. We are moving to a model where the walls will break so much that the outside world is going to enter into the schools. I believe this is going to happen in the next few years. Schools will no longer be independent to run their own curricula the way they used to. Industry, civil society organizations, business, political groups, they will demand that they will enter into the school and teach along with the teachers. They will demand that what the needs of society are introduced into the curriculum, into the system. They will demand that they go themselves and meet the kids and teach. It's already happening to some degree, but it's going to increase. And of course, kids are not constrained in the classroom anymore. They can be anywhere. They can be outside in the garden. They can be visiting. I don't know if you can see through the images that I put some kids here. Here and there and there. So visiting companies, visiting. Believe me, when my daughter was 8 to 12, we shared the times with my wife equally and fairly. 2 days me, 3 days she, to take her to school. When it was my day, I was telling her, do you really want to go to school or shall we go and play in the city? So she was skipping school and she was saying, Dad, don't I have to go to school to learn something? And I was saying, no, you're going to learn something much more today. And that's true. Don't believe that children will learn everything in the school. Now, the same way, we need to trust the system that kids visiting companies, printing houses, computer industries, financial industries, the forest, looking at animals, taking pictures of animals, then going to the Wikipedia and finding information about it, discussing, is much more important than the school, which is dry and which is not so much interesting. Yes, the message is not about making it happen. It's about letting it happen. Because I'm telling you, nobody can stop it. It's already happening. So I'm not here to ask you to do that or to encourage you to do it or to actively do something to make this happen. It's going to happen, only you can only delay it. That's the only thing you can do. So I'm asking you to let it happen. Now, a dream for Africa. That's your dream, but I want to share your dream, and I want to talk about a dream for Africa, and especially Kenya. I understand that there are people from 11 countries here, and of course, this is very interesting and very good, and if I can network with some of them, please talk to me. But I think Kenya, especially, is very well situated to help the whole of Africa. For many reasons, you know them better than me, and that's the reason I chose to come here when I was invited. Because a lot of things are happening in Kenya. And you are lucky as Kenyans, because a lot is happening here, but you know, luckiness comes with responsibility. You are also responsible for the rest of Africa. I keep saying this in my country. I come from a very small country, Cyprus. Cypriots all the time speak like victims. About against Europe, against the UN, against the Americans, against the Russians. And we have to remind them that we are a rich country and we also have responsibility to help other countries. So not always complaining about yourself, but see what you can do also for the countries around you. And Kenya is richer, has more peace, has more facilities to support countries around. Now, to share this dream, I'll tell you something that was my dream 20 years ago. And it started with a strong vision. Every dream is a vision. It comes out in a few words. To redefine the tools, the methods, and the purpose of education in light of relevant socio-techno-economic changes. Remember what I told you before? The what, the how, the when, and the why. So we need to change education so that it meets this criteria. Now, I called my dream Cyber Kids. That was about 20 years ago, in 91. I was a professor in the United States, and I gave up my job, and I went to my country to do this experiment, and I started schools everywhere, afternoon schools, private. People were paying us a lot of money as well, in order to introduce creativity into the lives of children. Our vision was that we cannot change the government. I know we have a very important government person here, but it's always difficult to convince the government and change the government. So we decided to invade in the country as three young people educated in the States and change the system without their permission. So we started schools everywhere, 36 schools, without a lot of money, but we were making money out of the system. And we had thousands of kids coming to play with computers, to run, to do programming, to do multimedia, and in a way we invaded into the system because we were also hiring teachers from the public education system to teach there. So they were then teaching also in their own schools using our methodologies. But what was the most important thing was the vision statement, that everything we were teaching had to satisfy these three words: to redefine the tools, the methods, and the purpose. So if you had a project, something that you want to teach, you had to look at it from these three angles. You don't just take the curriculum and say, I'm going to teach this unit today. You have to ask the question, what tools am I going to be using while I was teaching? I will be teaching that. So I embed the tools into my teaching. Why am I teaching it? Which methods? And more importantly, how it connects to real life. Why is that important for a kid? Do you think a kid cares about quadratic equations? They don't even know what they are. So if you want to teach them quadratic equations, go outside, give them water, and they can spray one another, and they see the water going like that, and then introduce the quadratic equations. They will remember them forever. Now, when we did this, we expanded heavily. 15% of the population became our students. And we got a lot of awards, we have curricula, everything is available for you, just send me an email, I'll give you access to everything. And it would be nice if we can share this with Africa. We had a lot of events, I'm sharing some pictures with you, but the important thing was that the child was in the center, the project was in the center. We went also to many other countries. We started these schools in 7 other countries. But the important thing, like I said, is that everything we were teaching was related to the real world. And everything was project-oriented. And everything introduced the computer. Now, this is a message I want to share with you. Because everybody talks about child-centered education. It's important that we put the child in the center. I am in favor of moving forward from that discussion. We don't need to talk about the importance of it. That's history. It is important. This is how it works. The challenge is to come up with ideas, local ideas. I heard before some of the speakers saying about African content. This is what you need to develop, African content, your projects that are related to your culture, your animals, your treasures. Protect them by making them known. Have kids do projects on all of these things. Now, a lot of the things I'm talking about, it's funny that this work was done about 20 years ago, but now it's becoming hot. So I was invited to write a chapter in a book, and it's available. It describes what I'm talking about. So if you want to read more about it, send me an email, I'll send you this chapter. It's going to be published in November. Sometimes I laugh with myself because we were doing this 2 decades ago and now the world is catching up. Now, like I said, the curriculum is public. I can give it to you. And if any of the countries that are here would like to introduce it, we would be more than happy to support you. We can replicate the experiment. But like I said, the experiment was with computers. Computers are also history now. You don't need them. They are also expensive. Now we have mobiles. They are cheaper. Everybody has a mobile. In a couple of years, more people will have mobiles. So the big challenge is how do we marry the mobile with education, with the country. And this needs some research, some international collaborations, some exchange of experiences. It needs a network. And that's why this kind of conferences is very good, because it allows people to network. Nobody can do anything alone anymore. Nobody can even solve any problem alone. We need collective intelligence to solve the problems. And this is the last issue I'm going to talk about, is that the world is becoming so complex that in order to change it and design the future, we need to work collectively. We don't believe in experts and elitism anymore. There is no man who can change the world. The time of big leaders, political, or big scientists is history. The problems are too big now. We need the collective to work together. And this is what I will be talking about in my last part. Can you go to the next one? The next one? Okay. There is a methodology called the science of dialogic design. This is a methodology that started from the ancient Greek. It's about democracy, about people discussing peacefully together and reaching some kind of consensus. It was redeveloped in the Club of Rome, and now we are developing it in the digital era. There are people around the world working on this idea. The idea is simple. We have here, let's say, 200 people. Is there any way we can add their intelligence? No. Is there any way we can add their wisdom? No. It's funny. Even two people, if you give them a task to solve, it takes longer than one alone. If you take a lot of people and give them the right to elect, they elect the wrong people. Why? Nobody asked this question. It's simple. Because they elect the average. They don't elect the best. This is called popular voting. What the majority wants is not always right if it's the average. You need a way to make them become more responsible before they choose. And this is what this science is about. And there are some books that you can read, and there are a lot of videos. But the background of it, I'm going to tell you how it is that some years ago, we used to write books. Now everything is digital. And from the time text became digital, we had an explosion of development in the world of text. The same with images. We used to paint them. Now they are digital. These guys, they were videotaping, and in a few minutes they would be broadcasting it. They are sending it over the air to go there. They can even change it. They can put subtitles. The same is true for music. I used to love my vinyl records. Now they come from YouTube. The same revolution is going to happen in the world of thinking. So this is what it is about. When people talk, they talk in relation to something. So if I ask you a question, what is your dream of Africa? And everybody gives an answer. These answers, they all have something in common. They are answers to the same question. The other thing they have in common is that they have a father or a mother. Somebody said that idea. Now, in the usual world, nobody takes care who says what. They can steal your ideas any moment. But with this methodology, we write down who said that, and that person is the owner of that idea. We give a number to the idea. That's idea number 32. That's idea number 34. Now, when we do that, in a way, we are digitalizing the ideas. They have a content. An idea has a title, but it also has a paragraph describing it. It can also have a video clip. Ideas can be grouped together into categories. So an idea has a belongingness in some category, has a clarification. We don't lose anything. That's very important. A lot of times we talk, we say very important things, and then we forget them. Nobody takes notes. Ideas grow. I say something, and then you ask me questions. And actually, when you ask me a question, I'm not sure I thought about it. In order to answer, I'm thinking about it. So thinking about it, the idea grows. We can search for similarities among ideas and make groups, like I said before. But the most important is that ideas may influence one another. Let's say I'm asking you things to do to convert Kenya into the leader of e-learning in Africa. And everybody has one idea. How do we decide whose idea is the most important? Popular voting? If we do popular voting, let's say we have 100 ideas on the wall, and I ask you to vote. The idea that will receive the maximum votes, let's say, is idea number 55. Now, if I continue with you, and I ask you questions, taking two ideas at a time, whether one idea might support the other, and then you discuss and you answer that question, and we build an influence tree, then the same people will reach a different conclusion. They will find that another idea is the most important. Now, this is erroneous priority. This is actually the scientific proof why democracy, as we know it, doesn't work. Because democracy is based on popular voting. Now, this is a dangerous thing to say, because if we don't have democracy, what should we have? I don't want us to go back to elitism. What I'm saying is that in order to choose the best, the same people need to discuss deeper. They need to search for influences of one idea on another. Now, to help this happen, we develop some software. We're developing a lot of different software. Everything is free. You can download it, send me an email, I can send it to you. This one is available now only for Apple mobile phones, but it will also be available for Android soon. It's called Idea Prism. It allows anybody to start a discussion about something. This is a thing beyond Facebook. In Facebook, you can talk about a lot of things, but they get lost. Now, this has a formula that forces the discussion focus. So anybody can start a discussion, and people have to organize their thoughts. There is always this question, what are we talking about? There is the response to the question. There is a video clip that you can upload explaining in 30 seconds what you mean so that people can go and see it. And we develop maps. This is an influence map. So the ideas are being structured. And with this way, we develop a vision. So if you want to develop a vision for the country, for mobile learning, for e-learning, for your role in Africa, you can use this methodology to develop it collectively, not imposed by anybody. It's a vision that comes from ordinary people, because it's ordinary people who live in an ordinary country. We don't want any expert to come and tell us what to do. I remember when I was a child, I was going to my grandmother's flowers, and I was cutting them and leaving only one so that it grows bigger. You know that trick? If you leave only one flower in one branch, that flower becomes bigger. So I was cutting all the flowers, and I was leaving only one flower in one branch. And she was coming after me, hitting me. Why are you cutting the flowers? And then one day I go there, and all the flowers were cut with my system. And I said to her, Grandma, you finally did it. She said, yeah, a guy from England came and told me that if I do this, the flowers get bigger. These are people, ordinary people from different workshops sharing their ideas. And this is what I would like to see you doing with mobile devices. Give the power to kids, to everybody, to say their idea, to organize their idea, and spread it to others. Because ideas are contagious. When there is a strong idea, a strong vision, other people with the same vision, they subscribe to it, it moves very fast. When you start something that is good, it will grow. That's all for today. Thank you very much. My email is there if you need to.
The greatest learning from me is the experience I had with the structured dialogue, with the methodology that we used in all these processes, which allows people to speak one after the other in a very civilized way. Everything we say is being registered. We feel that your idea is understood by the others and is respected by the others. Everyone is equal in the dialogue. But more importantly, is that by doing that, the people in the room develop what we call common language.